Welcome to the Free Flowing Health Podcast, where we invite you to embark on a transformative journey towards a healthier, happier, more fulfilling life. Each episode brings you a dynamic exploration of the diverse aspects of health, wellness, and healing. I'm your host, Lisa Brown. Join me as I engage in intimate conversations with inspirational guests who share their unique stories and insights. These conversations will take you beyond conventional thinking, encouraging you to break free from the constraints of a one-size-fits-all healing approach. Our mission is to empower you with the knowledge, tools, and motivation needed to inspire real change. Are you ready? Let's dive in. Welcome back, everybody, to the Free Flowing Health Podcast. Today's guest is joining all the way from Scotland. Jenna Hastie, welcome to the show. She's going to share her story about being diagnosed with all sorts of autoimmune conditions, having worked in the Western medical field as a nurse for 15 plus years, and then having created a healing modality to help uncover that missing piece. Well, Jenna, welcome to the show. You're going to dive much deeper into the story and tell our audience all about your journey.
Yeah, thank you so much for having me, Lisa. It's an absolute honor and a privilege to be here. So my name is Jenna Hastie, and I'm an autoimmune and chronic disease root cause specialist. As you were saying, I was a nurse. I was a registered nurse for 15 years. I started my training in 2003 and qualified in 2006. During my time working as a registered nurse, I worked in accident emergency, and I started developing mystery symptoms like extreme back pain, brain fog, fatigue. And the doctors pawned me off and basically said that it was down to being a new mum or being pregnant. And this kind of went on from around about 2012. And eventually I got diagnosed with chronic fatigue syndrome and fibromyalgia, anxiety and depression in 2016. With the long hours of working in accident emergency and just the kind of stress of that environment, I was working 12 to 13 hours a day on shifts, either day shifts, night shifts or weekends. And it got too much for my health. My health was really kind of suffering. So I decided to move into primary care, and I moved into primary care and embarked on a journey as a trainee advanced nurse practitioner. And I went back to university to study for my master's in advanced practice. And during that time in 2019, new mystery symptoms emerged, and I started having severe swelling to my hands. My back pain became unbearable. I became very stiff, and the joints in my feet and my ankles were really sore as well. And I was actually diagnosed with a condition called axial spondyloarthritis, which is an autoimmune arthritis. So basically my immune system was just attacking my joints in my back and in my hands and my feet. And I was put on immunosuppressants. So I was taking methotrexate, which is a low dose chemotherapy. I had to inject that every week. I was taking adalimumab, which is a biological, and that was injected every second week. And I was also on sulfasalazine, which is another immunosuppressant. And this all kind of, I hit rock bottom, I would say, in 2020. My immune system was completely, and I was told that if I was to leave the house, I would die if I caught COVID because of the state of my health. At that point, I was bedridden. I was on 15 to 20 tablets a day, which included painkillers, mood meds, and then medications to counteract the side effects of the medications that I was on. And as you can imagine, I spiraled into a really dark place. I felt really isolated. I lost my health. I didn't think I would ever get better. I was told that I had chronic, lifelong debilitating conditions and things would get worse. I was bedridden. I was a mum to two incredible girls who I couldn't play with. I couldn't experience life being a mum. My wee girls were 5 and 8 at the time, and I spiraled really, really, really into a dark place. I lost my career. I lost my half finished master's, and the majority of my friends couldn't handle it. So I lost them too. And I became really suicidal. And I didn't want to continue. I was in absolute agony, and I felt like a prisoner in my own body. My mind was there, but my body was just giving up. So it was tough. And if it wasn't for my incredible husband and our two beautiful daughters, I genuinely know that I wouldn't be here today. They gave me the strength to try and find something different, well, you know, and try.
I am so glad that you're here today and able to tell your story, with the hopes that maybe other people dealing with a similar condition can find some hope and some inspiration and some answers. So what was the exact turning point that led you from, you know, being so down on yourself and to the point of being suicidal? And obviously you're a career woman, you're highly educated, ironically enough, working in the health profession, obviously burnt out. And I know that's common, you know, advancing your studies, you're a mom, you're a wife. Like, where was the turning point, the aha moment that led you to that, you know, path of self-discovery?
So I think it was the turning point where I realized that there was nowhere else to go. I was at the furthest point. I was either here or I wasn't here. So I started researching and looking for just alternative ways. And all I wanted to do was get out of bed. I didn't think that, you know, I'd be off my medications. I just wanted to be able to be out of bed and play with my kids. That's all that mattered to me at this point. And I was doom scrolling one night, as you do, on Facebook, and I came across a mindset coach, a mindset and manifestation coach. And I just kind of started checking out her content and things, and everything kind of resonated really quite deeply. And I realized that my mindset was in the gutter. Like, I was very pessimistic, very doom and gloom. I think working in accident emergency for such a long time, where you're dealing with resuscitation cases on a regular basis, it can really just harden you up, you know? So realizing that I had to work on my mindset, I started kind of looking at, you know, things might actually be okay. I started kind of having a bit of hope, and I was researching and I was looking at neuroscience principles capable of rewiring my brain. I was reading up on Joe Dispenza, Louise Hay, the medical medium, and I was just kind of, I didn't have anything else to do. I was in bed, so, you know, I put my time to good use, and I started meditating. And I started visualizing, and there was one particular visualization I did every single day, and it was just getting out of bed and playing with my kids. And in my mind's eye, I could see the life that I just wanted, the life that I deeply craved for, and I could hear my girls' laughter in my head. And the feeling that it gave me was just unreal. I could feel the love on a physical level. It was like my heart was growing with this visualization. And this visualization became a lifeline to me, but it also became a building block to my recovery. I went into a spiritual awakening. And as I meditated, I would get these kind of downloads as to what I should do to try and improve my health. So bit by bit, I would try different kind of healing modalities, different techniques, and kind of combining my Western medical knowledge and ancient principles and also neuroscience principles. I started kind of piecing together bit by bit, and I managed to get out of the bed, and I managed to move down to the couch, which was fantastic because I was out of the bed and I could watch my kids. And, you know, I wasn't allowed outside because not only with the COVID, but also the medication that I was on, I couldn't be exposed to sunlight. So I got to watch my kids outside the window, watch them play, which was incredible. And then as I was meditating, it was, drop a painkiller, you don't need that. So I would drop a dose because the pain just seemed to minimize. My pain and my symptoms seemed to minimize. My energy seemed to increase. And bit by bit, I would stop one dose. And then I would stop another dose and another dose. And all of a sudden, I was off my Etodolac, which is a very high strength anti-inflammatory. And because I was off that, I could come off the omeprazole, which I was on to protect my tummy. And it just turned into a kind of snowball effect. Mm-hmm. And eventually, I was only on my immunosuppressant injections plus the medication to counteract their side effects. And I dropped the methotrexate, which meant that I could drop the folic acid and I could drop the anti-sickness medication. And I was very scared to drop the adalimumab. The adalimumab is means tested in the UK because it's a very expensive drug. It's about £300 per injection. So that kind of shows you how bad I was to be put on that medication. In regards to comparing it to the methotrexate's about £30 to £40 an injection. So there's a big, massive kind of jump there. So I was terrified. I didn't want to come off the adalimumab just in case. But as I'm meditating, you need to come off that. You need to come off that. So I came off it. And the last time I injected any of the immunosuppressants, last time I injected the adalimumab was the 27th of April, 2021. I have been off all of my medications. I'm coming up for 3 years in full remission. I'm medication free, I'm symptom free, I'm pain free.
I love that. That's amazing.
Incredible. Yeah, it's just incredible. I pinch myself. I can't actually believe it. I never set out to get into remission. I didn't ever think it was possible. Being around the Western medicine, your chronic means chronic, lifelong means lifelong. Right. I never ever once thought that I'd be sitting here right now.
And just looking at you, you're so vibrant and youthful looking and all of that. You. It's almost hard. It's so hard to believe. What was the time frame? So when you found the mindset coach online, and then you begin to open yourself up to various types of meditation and mindset work, what was that time frame where it took you to actually get out of bed and start to wean off the meds?
Yep. So I started getting kind of out the bed probably a month in. I took in total probably, that was April, May. So about 5 months in total, but there was a lot of trial and error, and now I've honed in what works and what doesn't. And I teach people all over the globe to do the same. And my clients gain comparable results, and they see results within 8 to 12 weeks, which is
phenomenal. And it's good to have a, you know, educated healthcare professional guiding people through, so you can bridge the gap between the esoteric, the metaphysical, as well as the, you know, empirical evidence-backed science methodology as well. And I'm sure it's not smart to come off of all of your medications at once, especially if you're on multiple medications there's probably a whole system to that. So it started off with mindset. Did you actually hire a coach, or was it just through absorbing the knowledge and reading and research that you began to implement these techniques?
I went with the manifestation coach, Noor Hibbert. I joined her monthly membership. That's all I could afford. It was a monthly membership, her GFTI Academy. And that just gave me the courage and the support. And she was incredible. She really was. She was a light for me, you know.
Right. So, okay, starting off with the mindset, and that's, you know, obviously a vital part of the healing process. Did that mindset shift and doing this internal work lead to you making other changes in your life? Can you speak a little bit about the other things that you incorporated into your healing process?
So I started processing past traumas, processing past kind of childhood wounds, because I became to realize that a lot of kind of trapped emotion, if you don't actually process it, your body actually knows the score.
Keeps the score.
It's incredible. So eventually, you know, this mental anguish comes out in a physical level. So it was a case of working on my mindset, fighting my limiting beliefs, dealing with childhood trauma, trauma in general, and trauma and childhood wounds. It doesn't need to be something catastrophic. It can be as simple as being bullied as a child, where I was exceptionally bullied all throughout secondary school. And it can also be, you know, stress upon stress. It doesn't need to be something catastrophic for it to actually traumatize you as either a child or as an adult. And then once I had a strong foundation within my mind, I moved on to the body. And with the body, I looked at nutrition. It's true what they say, you are what you eat. I went through an extensive elimination diet, which highlighted to me that dairy caused a significant amount of inflammation for myself. So I am now dairy free. I've been dairy free since all of this has happened. So, and then I looked at nervous system regulation, adrenal fatigue, and dealing with chronic stress, and then also creating ways to have coping strategies for stress. We live in this modern world that is stressful. We're stressed at every turn, you know, in this today's society. So it's getting tools and techniques so that you can master that. And then with the soul, I worked with kind of energy, chakra realignments, and also finding who I am at the core. Do you know, like, I think as women especially, we lose track of who we are. And so it was a very deep dive, self-discovery, and also finding my purpose, which is what I'm doing now. I'm living my dharma. I didn't actually think that I would ever find anything that gave me so much joy than nursing. But this is just absolutely incredible. So if anyone ever offered me, you know, I'll take all that suffering off you and you can get your old life back, I would say no. I would have went through it all again to be the person that I am today. I love the person that I am today. And that's another thing. A lot of self-love is needed as well, right, on this healing journey.
And those experiences kind of guide and shape your path. Like, we go through hard things to build resilience, to gain that additional knowledge, and to push us to the next level of not only healing, but then being that beacon of light for others and helping them along their path and their journey. You know, I had a really similar path to you. And as you speak, it resonates really deeply. When I was just like around 18, working full time as an EMT, so not quite a nurse practitioner, but also in college full time, you know, working full time, competing in powerlifting competitions, putting everybody else's needs first, burning myself out, not dealing with unprocessed childhood wounds and traumas, not paying attention to what I was putting into my body. So just consuming standard American diet, you know, everyday foods, and over caffeinating, not sleeping, the whole nine. And it got to the point where I was so severely burnt out. My hormones were so out of whack. I, ironically enough, ended up in the ER with, you know, bleeding and hormonal issues. And although well-intentioned, the doctors put me on massive amounts of hormone therapy at 18 years old, birth control if they didn't want me to cycle for a year, even though I wasn't sexually active, invasive testing, you know, especially just a male dominated, I feel like, industry at that time, and sent me on my way with zero education. And I also reached a really dark place. I know what it's like to want to end my life, a face full of cystic acne, couldn't even face the world, extreme anxiety, depression, you name it. And it was all, you know, it was that experience that pushed me into researching further and beginning to learn about mindset, about nutrition, about all of the spiritual things, having these various awakenings. So sometimes it's like one line in a book, you know, one conversation that you have with somebody that gives you that little glimpse of hope. Like in your case, seeing that post from the mindset coach on Facebook that leads you down this path. So, you know, like just letting anybody out there now, it doesn't matter what you're struggling with. It can be a multitude of, you know, medical issues. It can be psychological, mental, that I just want to, you know, bring people on that are so inspirational like you to share your story, to show that there is a way, and it just takes one tiny little change to lead to the next. And, you know, that there is hope. So when you were at your lowest of low, and there was a point that you probably felt hopeless, right?
Yeah. I was plotting ways of how to end it, and I came to the conclusion of gathering up all my immunosuppressants and taking them all at once, taking all my medication at once, you know, and you do, you start thinking of how you do it, and then all of a sudden your little kids come into the room to see how you are, and then you think, I can't give this, I can't pass that on to them. I can't do that to them, do you know?
Right. So you had the children and you had the husband, which was like, you know, really pivotal in you being able to climb out of this hole. So what advice, I guess, would you give to anybody struggling, no matter what they're struggling with? Let's say they don't have a family and they're feeling so isolated and alone, especially because you've, you know, dealt with these dark thoughts and you've been almost immobile, stuck in bed. Anybody maybe who's feeling that lack of support, where can they start to climb themselves out of that hole? Like, what is the advice that you can give to that person listening right now?
There is always hope, mm-hmm. And there's always a way to find strength. I mean, if I had been successful with at my darkest moments, I wouldn't be here now. You know, what you're experiencing right now will change. Everything changes. Change is inevitable. You just need to keep that hope and begin to love yourself. And be your best friend. You're the person that you go to bed with at night. You're the person that shares all your tears with, your joys, your sadness. So you need to just start kind of treating yourself with love. And good things will come when you start actually seeing yourself for the absolutely incredible person that you actually are, because you are incredible.
That
You're
is
special.
So beautiful. Yeah. And if somebody, you know, is not happy with the meds and the side effects, and maybe that's, you know, leading to further ill health, obviously we don't want to, like we already mentioned, say just come off the meds.
No.
So how would you suggest somebody go about maybe like exploring other realms of healing? And then how do they deal with, you know, the side effects of coming off of the meds? Do they need to seek professional help when it comes to that? What is your suggestion?
Yeah, so start with uncovering your hidden root causes. And once you know where these kind of root causes lie, whether it's within the mind or past trauma or within the body, and you start healing these. And then as you get stronger, if it's painkillers that you're on, it depends what painkillers you're on. If you're on the likes of anti-inflammatory, there's no withdrawal with that. So you could just drop a dose and see how you are. Miss a dose and see how you are. But generally speaking, you must talk to your GP. You must talk to your yes. family doctor, because some medications are for life. Some medications you need to take that, you know, they're keeping your heart ticking. They're keeping, you know, the blood thin to prevent clots. There are specific things that, you know, are required. But there's also medications. I was on very strong codeine, and there's withdrawal with that. Especially if you've been on it for such a long time. I started getting a prescription of cocodamol back in 2011. I was on that for such a long time, almost a decade I was on codeine. So you need to, you know, have a plan in place to wean yourself down. But to begin with, you need a strong foundation. So you need to be healing. You need to be doing the work first before you even consider coming off the medications. And that's what I teach my clients. And they do. They need to consult their doctors. Obviously, with my medical background, I just kind of went for it. And I don't suggest that people do that.
That is logical. That is logical and sound advice. And I appreciate that. Anybody listening out there, I'd love to just paint a picture of, you know, you talked a little bit about the symptoms that you had when you were sick and all of that. What were some of the positive benefits on all levels that you experienced over time by the time you were fully healed? Like, was it clearer skin? Was it more energy? Was it a stronger physical body? If you just want to speak to, like, you put in the work, you uncovered all these different aspects of healing and wellness, slowly began to incorporate, you know, these lifestyle changes and mindset changes. So can you just speak to some of the positive benefits, maybe some that weren't even, you know, in your realm of expectation?
Yeah. So an abundance of energy now. And I used to be so fatigued, even just, you know, washing my hair. I couldn't even wash my hair. It was just so tiring. Wow. So just an abundance of energy, being able to run and chase after my kids and go on trampolines and do all that kind of stuff and go sledging with my kids and all that. But also my skin improved. I feel that I look younger. I'm 40 this year. And I feel that I feel like I look younger than what I did, which is,
you don't look a day over 22. Yeah.
Oh, really? I think you're being a wee bit kind, but so come July I will be 40, and I've never had any Botox or anything like that. So definitely the clearer skin, brighter eyes as well. I just looked very dull and puffy from the steroids and things, you know. Clear mindset, such a sharp mind now, whereas before I'd maybe lose the remote control for the TV and I'd find it in the fridge, do you know. I'd have such brain fog, so that for sure. And just I just feel healthier and I'm happier, and like I've never felt so alive. It's incredible. Yes. Like I feel like I've got more life in me now than I have ever had. It's phenomenal.
On a deeper spiritual level, was there something that you were lacking or denying? Like you said, you eventually connected and aligned with your purpose. You spent a good amount of your time as a nurse practitioner. So, you know, great physical benefits, more clarity, more energy. You're able to now like do things you weren't able to before. But working even in the realm of manifestation, was there something that was like really deep that was missing that you needed to give to yourself that you became aware of as you went through this healing process, if that makes sense?
Yeah, of course. So actually from a young age, I used to feel that I could sense energy, and I could see auras from a very young age. And I would say these things, and I would say that, you know, I had this dream and this happened, and everybody just thought that I was crazy. And there's a magazine called Treasures of the Earth that was out, and I used to collect it, and it was, you would get crystals, and I was obsessed with the crystals, but I could feel the energies with the crystals, and I was made to feel strange and weird, and that it wasn't normal. And being brought up as a Catholic, you know, these are not the things that you should be saying. So that got packed away, and it got forgotten, and it got put into a little box. And when I started meditating and going on this spiritual journey, I realized that I'd hidden a big part of me, like such a big, big part of me. And it was so healing for my inner child to just accept that part of me again and to let it come out. So finding myself again.
I love that. And those innate gifts that we push away because of societal conditioning, and you know, we do things because we think that we need to do them and all of that. Like, was becoming a nurse part of your higher calling, or did you do it just to be able to create abundance for yourself? Or was there some sort of calling? Like, was that part of the reason why you got sick? I'm just wondering, like, what led to that, you know, the severity of your symptoms and becoming that ill? And I guess, was it progressive or was it more overnight?
It was progressive. It was progressive. But in regards to becoming a nurse, I was actually training to be a silversmith. When I was 18, I was in the middle of training to be a silversmith, and my granddad became really unwell, and he had stomach cancer, and he was in the hospital, and I saw the way the nurses were with him, and I just thought, they are incredible, and I want to do that. And I changed. Yeah. I just changed, and I was like, "That's me. I'm not doing the silversmithing anymore. I'm gonna go, and I'm gonna become a nurse." So looking and back, I think
nurses are amazing, by the way. Yeah. So it's part of your life path, but obviously the strenuous schedule, and obviously putting other people's needs first all of the times, and the long hours, and all of that. Mm-hmm. Leads to burnout for a lot of people. So do you think that there's anything inherently within the healthcare system, you know, having done that for so long, that needs to change to ensure that medical professionals can fill up their own cup and be present for others without sacrificing their own health.
Oh, 100%. I think the shift pattern is ridiculous. I think expecting people to be working 12, 13 hours nights, then on to days and whatnot, I think that that's detrimental. I think there's no support either. Like, working in accident emergency and you're in VSUS and there's maybe house fires or whatever, you see horrible sights and it's very sad and you get no support. There's no counselling, there's nobody to talk to, there's nothing. And then you're just expected to kind of pack it all away and go home and be normal because you don't want to burden your family with the horror stories.
Yeah, and as we know, not being able to debrief or have that time to process or even take care of yourself, it's like all that stuff is going to grow inside of you. And that's where dis-ease within the body. So, you know, not having dealt with the childhood wounds and the traumas, you know, whether conscious or subconscious, no matter how big or tiny, small, you know, small T, big T's, but then also on an everyday basis, having to show up fully and witness probably some hard things that are hard to stomach and care for people and just even the physical component of it, how exhausting it is. So I can imagine that that was a big wake up call for you to be able to finally implement self-care and, you know, do what you're doing now in the world. So then you went on to write a book. Can you speak to that a little bit? What the book is called, what it's about, how people can find it?
Yeah, so it's actually a compilation. Thank you. Sorry.
Okay.
I've got dyslexia, sorry. So some words are quite tricky to come out. So it's basically an anthology. There's 25 women. So we had a chapter each and it's called Unstoppable Stories. And it's 25 incredible women with incredible stories that could have went the absolute opposite way, but with strength and determination, we have managed to turn things around and come out the other side stronger and more capable than ever before. All proceedings go to suicide prevention, which is obviously a very big thing for me with just my past history and things. So you can purchase it on Amazon. Kindle is available as well. So it's called Unstoppable Stories.
I love that so much. You know that we're the same age. I feel like we're soul sisters. I'm right now taking part of a collaborative book effort and just working on my chapter right now. It's amazing. So funny, like the reflections and who you attract and how in alignment, you know, that all is, especially when you put the call out. And I just realized, you know, whoever's watching this, I kind of rushed to set up this whole thing today and forgot to put on the lighting. So it's going to look dark and ominous. Anybody watching this on YouTube, you know, this is going to come out probably July or August, but totally forgot to set up the lighting. It was too late. We're just going with the flow. It's all good. At least anybody listening doesn't have to worry about that. Okay. So is there anything else that you would like to talk about? Do you want to talk about, you know, you talked a little bit about the philosophy and you work with people. Is there a methodology that you take people through, or is it intuitive process and different with each person? Is it one-on-one? Do you do group work? Just talk a little bit about, now dive into the work that you do and what that looks like on a daily basis.
Yeah. So I teach my healing modality, the 3D healing method. So it encompasses the mind, body and soul. And yes, it is a personal level. However, I give them all the information regarding everything for them to then work out. That makes sense. That I resonate with that. I'm lacking here and whatnot. So I work either one-to-one, I do group programs as well, and I also have a membership. And what we go through is, if it's the 12-week one-to-one course or the 12-week group program, it's initially 4 weeks solidly on the mind. We begin with educational videos each week with workbooks, audios, breath work, brain training, meditations, visualizations, whatever is relevant for that actual module. And I meet with my clients every single week for our one-to-one sessions. They do the educational content and they see what they need to discuss and what they need to let go of. And I'm also there to kind of call out limiting beliefs and things that they're maybe not quite aware of. I think that's really important too. So
I think it's so important to hire a coach and to be able to have that guidance. There's so many blind spots. There's, you know, so much that a coach can extract and help people along the process. So, you know, and everybody has their unique story, their unique spin on things, their unique background and education to bring to the table. So I love how you brought it all together, and, you know, you're working with people in a way that's truly transformative.
Yeah.
Anything else you'd like to say? Yeah.
Just by working with someone, it just kind of 10x's your, you know, how quickly you're going to get better as well, you know, rather than kind of fumbling in the dark, kind of going, I'll try this and I'll try that, you know. I definitely don't think that my mindset would have rushed so quickly, you know, to get so better, you know, so much better, if I hadn't have had kind of the guidance of my mentor at the time. I do think it's really important that we do have someone that we can be accountable to, just so that we're staying on track. It's easy to kind of derail as well, you know. You think,
exactly,
I'm feeling a wee bit better, so because I feel a wee bit better, I'm going to be a wee bit lazy, so I'll just not do X, Y, and Z. And then you realize, actually, I need to do all of that. It's a lifestyle. Do you know?
Exactly. And life happens, struggles and challenges will surface. And sometimes that sets us back. So it's always great to have somebody connected and invested in our outcomes and really, you know, there to help us get back on track. I'd love to know now that your life is different. You're an entrepreneur, you have your own business. So you're no longer, you know, plagued by the crazy 12-hour day schedule and, you know, in that hospital setting. So what does your life look like now, and how do you find that work-life balance to keep yourself on track as a coach?
Yeah, so
and a mentor.
I found it quite difficult transitioning from, you know, going out and going to your work and having your specific amount of hours and things. It's very easy to be like, oh, I've got a bit of a headache, I'm just not gonna go and do anything, or you're just like working all hours, you know. So it's, you need to set up boundaries, and I think it took me a wee while to realize that I needed to do that. I've got a new coach at the moment, and he said to me last week, the cows still need milking. And I was like, what? And he was basically just saying, you know, for farmers, it doesn't matter if there's been an illness, it doesn't matter if there's been even a bereavement, the cows still need milking. If the cows don't get milked, the cows will get sick. So that is, I don't know why, but it's really stuck to me, do you know? And yes. I think it's incredible to be kind of thinking like that. But I love my life now, and it's, you know, it can be as slow-paced or as fast-paced as I want. It can be as full as I want, or it can be as loose as I want, you know. So it's nice to just ebb and flow, especially as women, we have a monthly cycle, so it's good to be able to correspond. Yeah, so I work with the moon quite a lot as well, so the phases of the moon and things, so I quite like to plan about in regards to like my hormones and whatnot as well, when I've got more energy and things like that. So it's incredible being able to do that.
I started actually implementing that as well. It's so funny, later in life, because, you know, you're not really taught that growing up in school. And it's like, as you grow and evolve as a woman, and it's important to like take that into consideration and really plan around the cycles of the moon and what's happening, you know, internally with your hormones and your flow and all of that. So I love it. Mm-hmm. So you mentioned self-love and self-care earlier when we opened up this episode. So I'm just wondering if there's specific tactics or things that you do on a daily basis or weekly basis or even monthly basis that have really helped, you know, spark that dive inward to help you, you know, cultivate more self-love and ensure that you're caring for yourself. Because somebody listening might not know what that means, or they've never put the attention towards themselves, especially women with families and careers and all of that. So maybe just us talking about how we implement self-care and what self-love means to us can inspire somebody to begin to make some changes and begin to implement some of these tools and techniques. So yeah, what does it look like for you?
So for self-love, I really didn't love myself, and it was a very hard process. I wasn't nice to myself. I wasn't kind to myself. I spoke very badly of myself. So I actually adopted one of Louise Hay's principles, and it was mirror work. So looking in a mirror, putting your hand on the mirror and just looking yourself dead in the eye and basically saying, I love you. And looking at yourself and just, and it's so awkward. It's so awful at the beginning. You feel, it just doesn't feel right. But you keep on doing it and you keep on doing it and you begin to love yourself. And I became to realize that what was saying earlier, you are your own best friend. You are the person that has spent every single day of your life with you. You've been there from your first breath to your last breath. No one else is doing that with you. So it's so important to just treat yourself as you would treat your friends. Why do we not do that? Why do we not do that? And in regards to self-care, morning routines, nighttime routines. So I like to just make sure that I'm meditating. So I meditate in the morning, I'll meditate at night. They're non-negotiables. I have a hot tub that I quite enjoy using under the moonlight when there's the full moon. So I quite like being in water and meditating in water. That's good. If the weather's bad, I would make a really nice goddess bath. So lots of potions and lotions and crystals and all sorts, and just relax and meditate. That's just the thing that fills me. It really fills me up. And walking my dog and going out and just being in nature as well is very important. So how about you? What do you do?
Oh, I do everything you said and more. So definitely if I had a hot tub outside, I'd be bathing in the moonlight all of the time, but I settle for an Epsom salt bath, and I like to play with different essential oils to really, you know, influence the mood. I like to add lavender or dried rose petals and play around with that. And I feel like I am most creative in the bathtub. I don't know if it's just the element, the free-flowing element of water. But it's just like, if I can only choose one thing at the end of the day to clear my energy, especially as an empath, which I know you can relate to, and a lot of women out there can as well. Mm-hmm. It's just getting into an Epsom salt bath, hot water, maybe listening to a podcast or something that I find really fascinating and I'm better able to absorb and download the information. Sometimes it's just nature sounds. I love to be physically active. So whether it's jogging, walking, just getting outside, or doing a 20-minute exercise routine if I have no time, like I need to do that for me. Movement is medicine, and it is self-love and self-care, and helps keep me grounded. Definitely take some time for reflection. Meditation means a lot of different things to a lot of different people, and there's so many different types out there that resonate. And mine has evolved, especially as a meditation yoga teacher. So where it used to be, you know, chanting for 30 minutes every single day, the same mantra, or, you know, now it could look like a walking meditation. It can look like counting my breaths, and it can look like so many different things. So I like to say just taking time for reflection and, you know, having boundaries with technology. So 8 a.m. to 8 p.m. is the time that I can be doing work, answering messages, posting on social media, working on projects. But for me, self-care and self-love is making that distinction between work time and me time, which for a long time, I didn't understand the importance. So those are like my top priorities. And I can keep going on and on and on if we had like 3 hours. But boundaries with technology.
I thought I'd just give you a little...
you know, a lot of similarities there. So like my advice to people is to really just tune into what makes you feel alive, what makes you feel relaxed, what you actually enjoy doing, what are you passionate about, and like carve out time, put it onto your calendar, schedule it so that you can really, you know, engage in it. Because if it's just in the ethers, in our mind, just an idea, it's never going to be grounded in reality and rooted. So definitely everybody listening, find out what makes you feel amazing, what you consider to be self-love and self-care, whether it's journaling, it doesn't matter what it is.
Or I love art, so I love doing, I love getting creative, painting, drawing, like you name it. I've tried all different. I'm a manifesting generator, so I tend to go and try something, get really good at it, and then get bored of it, so I try something else. So that's another thing for me, like just finding joy, what sparks joy, and just do that.
So important. And getting in the flow state, whether it's through music or art. For me, it's cooking. Obviously, I work as a chef, and that's how my creative, you know, abilities are really honed, and practice is through like the love of food and all of that. So there's endless ways really that people can find their joy, find self-care, find self-love. And I know we're nearing the end of this episode, so I love to ask all my guests towards the end what free-flowing health means to you.
Listening to your soul and doing what you need at that time. So if one day you just need to chill and be still, then chill and be still. Other days you might be wanting to run a marathon, and that's cool. You just listen from within and really, really hone in on within, and you won't do wrong by doing that.
Awesome. And I love to hear people's unique responses. It's so much fun. Before you tell people how they could work with you and connect with you and the whole nine, are there any last words of wisdom that you would like to impart on your audience? Is there a message that you would like to share?
I think it's important that we all realize that we have this innate power within us. We all have this power within us to heal and to change our realities. So as I said already, go within. Just really try and go within and find out who you are at the core, because life just gets better and better once you have an understanding of who you are.
Yes, and you're living proof of that. So I love it. Love it that you're here sharing your story. Can you share all of the ways, and of course we'll include it in the show notes, but all of the ways that people can connect with you, follow you on social media, and so forth and so on?
Yeah, of course. So I'm on Facebook, Instagram, TikTok, and it's all under the same handle, Genology UK. I have a private Facebook group. It's a wee community that I give free information, free masterclasses and things, because I think it's important to give back as well. Not everybody can afford to, you know, have a coach and whatnot. So I think it's important to still share your wisdom. I've also got a website, www.genology.co.uk. I do one-to-one sessions. I do group sessions as well. So, yeah.
Awesome. Well, thank you for sharing so generously. And last question is, what kind of impact would you like to have on the world, or what kind of legacy would you like to leave?
So my big, hairy, scary dream, my goal, is to get the 3D healing method basically into the mainstream, because I think I know that it's a missing piece of the puzzle with Western medicine, and I'm not against Western medicine. It has its place, but we also need root cause healing, and I think that it's the missing piece of the puzzle. So that's what I want. I want it to be mainstream. I want to be able to help as many people as I possibly can, and just share this wisdom with everybody.
Thank you so much. Well, anybody listening, stay connected. If you need a coach, you know where to find her. And thank you so much for being here and for being so courageous and authentic. And I appreciate your beingness. And till the next time, everybody, thank you.
Thank you so much, Lisa. Thank you.
Thank you so much for tuning in to the Free Flowing Health Podcast. Your support means the world to us. Help us grow by leaving a positive rating and review. Make sure to subscribe, like, and share this podcast. If you'd like to stay connected, you can find me on social media at Free Flowing Health, or visit my website directly, freeflowinghealth.com. Wishing you a happy, healthy, and fulfilling life. Till the next time.
This podcast is intended for entertainment and informational purposes only and should not be considered legal, health, or professional advice. We are not responsible for any losses, damages, or liabilities that may arise from the use of this podcast. This podcast is not intended to replace professional or medical advice. Views and opinions expressed by the guest are those of the guests and do not necessarily reflect the view of the host or the Free Flowing Health team.